Hey there, citizens. I am Pruitt, and this is Jim Davis. And on today's WebDM, we're going to explore why some players see a yellow dress while some see a blue. Some hear Yanni instead of Laurel. So let's discuss cosmic conflicts, DMs. Would you like to know more? The devils are at our doorstep.
Yes.
It's right outside the window. You can't ignore it anymore. The cosmic conflict, whatever it is here.
It rages.
It rages against the machine of your campaign
rages
world.
And burns across the multiverse.
What to you is a good cosmic conflict? Like, how do you define that?
A conflict that has a larger impact on your setting and your world, and it ties your specific setting into some kind of larger cosmos.
Right.
And so there are cosmic conflicts that are prepackaged in the baseline lore of Dungeons & Dragons. Mordenkainen's Tome of Foes is sort of like half the book is detailing some of those conflicts.
Right, right.
I personally don't see elves and the elf and dwarf Dwergar conflicts as cosmic scale. They might involve gods, they might involve multiple planes, but like the beef between the elf gods and the drow gods and their respective peoples is not like, say, the Blood War.
Right.
Or something like that, where it's just like an order of magnitude bigger. Likewise for the dwarves and Dwergar, it's like the Dwergar are a clan of dwarves that have gone astray. I actually think, personally, that's the most interesting of the conflicts in Mordenkainen's Tome of Foes, but it's not cosmic in scale, where the other ones that are detailed therein are if they're included in your game world, if you include the Blood War, for instance, in your game world, then you have to answer some hard questions, things like, why hasn't this spilled over into your world?
Right.
Why hasn't it engulfed the entire cosmos at this point? Thinking through these kind of large-scale conflicts, how do you include them in your game? What do you do with them once you have included them in your game? And ways you can incorporate them are important, because I think if you do have a cosmic conflict, you're, number one, you're laying the foundation for higher-level play. You're laying the foundation for the things that your tier 3 and 4 characters can get involved in, that has the kind of scale and scope that's befitting for characters of those levels, but you've baked it in from the beginning. It's not like you've got to run around like, oh shit, they made it to level 13, I didn't realize that was going to happen, what am I going to do now? If you've been thinking about it from the beginning and going like, here are the large-scale conflicts that involve other parts of the multiverse, that involve other planes and great powers and deities and forces that are larger, like almost too large to comprehend, and almost to the point where the players can't necessarily affect the whole thing at once.
Right. Just their little piece of how it's, of where it's encroached in their world.
Right, right. I mean, unless you are going for a very high-powered kind of campaign where the players are big planar movers and shakers, and the decisions they make and the actions they take have planar level consequences as opposed to, say, village level or country level or world level consequences. My fighter is a, you know, a planar warlord that leads armies that are, you know, hundreds of thousands of beings strong with, you know, all of the monster manual at my disposal to create this force. That's much different than like a local warlord with 30 mercenaries at their disposal. Even though the, you know, concept's kind of vaguely the same. There are these conflicts that are big and tie your setting into a larger whole, and if you're going to include them, you need to think them through, because just throwing one in and sort of forgetting about it doesn't do the idea of a cosmic conflict justice.
Because when considering that, you know, a DM, is it the foundation in which you rest your campaign on, or is it just window dressing for your campaign to give it some kind of otherworldly feel, right?
Right, right. I kind of see like two approaches to that. Is this conflict the centerpiece of the campaign? For a lot of players who are coming into Dungeons & Dragons and role-playing in general from recently, this might be the only style of game they're familiar with. This is the big damn quest style, right?
Yeah.
Where from level one through when you stop playing, there's a central threat, a central plot, a central something that your characters are dealing with, and they kind of work their way up the food chain of enemies until they get to the big bad. There's a big showdown. Personally, I don't find that style of play very satisfying. I just don't.
You don't want to be the Avengers all the time?
I don't. I don't always want to be the Avengers. And I think D&D does work better with shorter arcs. Use the air quotes around arcs, because it's not like a TV show or something, you know. obviously. Yeah. But you know, a short little adventure. This is, we're done with this portion of it within 8 to 12 sessions, and then we move on to another thing, or we go to a different part of the map and get involved with something else. And then along the way, we deal with ramifications from this other thing that happened, right, and then right. a random event occurs because the dungeon master. And then like out of that mix comes a campaign. Whereas the big damn quest is more, this is what we're doing. There might be side quests. There might be personal stuff we get involved in. But there's always, we always know what the default is. We pursue the main quest line. And I think like a cosmic conflict works for that because you can start early. Let's take the first adventure module that came out for 5th edition. The Tyranny of Dragons is a cult of draconic cultists who have been taken over by a religious faction from their original function. Now they're seeking to bring the deity that they worship into the world, but that deity that they worship is part of a larger conflict itself, and so it has allies that are trying to get Tiamat out of hell. And at the same time, the way I did it at least, there were other factions that opposed that, so that the party eventually had devils working for them and against them. Mm-hmm. That's like one example of the sort of a structure for the campaign. The players catch wind of the cultists while they're doing something kind of mundane, and then they work their way up the food chain, constantly overcoming enemies, et cetera, et cetera. That's one way.
Okay.
You've got your cults and your lieutenants, and you'll establish a plot, and you hope that the players follow it, and if they don't, you'll ask for advice later. Mm-hmm. And my advice will be, you present the information, and if they take it, they take it. If they don't, they walk away. And if that ends your campaign because you have presented a world-threatening power that they didn't stop, then it ends your campaign, and yeah, you'll have to do something.
Sometimes the world ends and the sun gets blotted out.
That's one way. The other way is to do everything else. You've got the cultists. They've got their plot. They're going to do something. They're working. They're scheming. They're gathering resources. They're pursuing their own goals. The players may or may not come across this. They might come across it once, and then they're gone. And they might come across it after it's become a problem that's too big. That might be the thing, is like, no one found out about the cult of the fish demon in time, and now they've summoned the fish demon, and the fish demon is here, and we now have to deal with that.
Yeah.
That's one way of doing it, where you've just got your setting sprinkled with little things, and you've got NPCs and factions and everything else doing their own thing. It's not just the kingdom and the guild and the mages and the whatever. It's the crazy nihilistic death cultists who worship Orcus and believe that if they bring Orcus to the world, it will result in a glorious undead paradise for everybody else or something. Mm-hmm. And the party accepts that risk when they find the cult and what it's doing. And if they choose to not pursue it because they're like, yeah, we're really wanting to do other things, then they choose to not pursue it.
Yeah.
And you now have to think through the ramifications of that and the consequences of introducing these kinds of conflicts into your campaign world.
Let's run through a couple of examples, because you mentioned like the Blood War. What does that look like in your campaign world? Like, what's some ways that you can make that, like, introduce that as part of the campaign world?
Mm-hmm. So the Blood War is, a conflict within evil. This assumes that the traditional Dungeons & Dragons alignment is, you know, true for the campaign world. It assumes the Great Wheel cosmology for the Outer Planes. And it assumes that there are two factions of evil, Law and Chaos, which are at odds with one another. That they want evil to take over the rest of the planes, to crush good, to subjugate the lawful planes and the chaotic planes as well. And then it's just a matter of, well, is it going to be the demons or is it going to be the devils?
Yeah. And is it ordered good or crazy good?
And then whether or not the Yugoloths are involved in playing both sides against the middle is another thing. I personally, when it comes to the Blood War, I feel like the Yugoloths are a third wheel. We don't necessarily need them. I know that they are sort of canon, and in Planescape they were brought in as these sort of schemers and mm-hmm. backbiters and plotters, but to me it's like, that's the devils. The devils are the schemers and the plotters and the backbiters and, or, you know, the
backstabbers.
Yeah,
it becomes like a little bit of a crowded threesome there. Yeah.
I didn't even touch the other fiends that are in all the other lower planes that get caught up. Those poor fiends, those poor Garrulous and Ferostus. That's the Blood War in a nutshell. Chaos and Law fighting each other. It's one of those things where in the lore of the setting, it's never been fully articulated how the Blood War starts, what does the Blood War look like. it's suggested that it's so massive as to be an unwieldy concept. Like, the first time I read it, it was just like, what are you talking about? Like, a battle with millions of participants per side, and fiends and powerful demon lords and archdevils and things, like, going to the mortal world looking for souls, looking for agents, looking for fodder for their armies. It really, to me, the first time I saw it, was like, why isn't this the focus of, like, every D&D campaign? This would be the conflict. Like, what do the angels think of this? What do the other celestials think of the conflict? Why would they not go down to the mortal world and try to recruit their own agents and allies?
Yeah, I think they're probably too busy being that popcorn-eating gif.
Right. Mm-hmm. So a dungeon master has to decide, am I going to include the Blood War and all that it entails in my campaign? And if so, number one, why is it not the central focus if it's the scale that it's suggested? And if it is, how do you make any kind of sense of that and make any sort of a game out of a conflict on that scale? Mm-hmm. And so maybe it's a case of, like, we know that there are demons and devils that exert influence in the mortal world, which means they must have agents, cultists, warlocks, mad prophets, you know, all these kinds of things. Those NPCs in the game world have agendas and motives and the like. They will seek to gain allies for themselves, thwart their enemies. The mm-hmm. machinations of those things might draw in the party. It might not. Maybe it's just a rumor. Maybe it starts as something like rival gangs in the capital city are starting to seek support of warlocks and cultists and the like for some reason, right? For some reason, the devils want control of the underworld that's there. One of the demon lords finds out about it. They start a counter cult. Mm-hmm. Now you've got a gang war that's a proxy war between, say, Grozzitz and Asmodeus or something like that. That is something that a low-level party can get involved in. Well, we thought it was a turf war between rival gangs or something like that. The dock gang and the warehouse gang. And then as you work through it, you realize, oh, there's cultists involved. What do the cultists want? Oh, there's two cults involved. Mm-hmm. What are they doing? And now by the time you're late tier two, we've got a clear idea that there are big-time fiends involved in this conflict. What are they trying to do? Open up a new front in the Blood War, right? Bring the conflict to this prime material world where both sides can wage war without worrying about someone, about their own side dying permanently.
Well, yeah, because they just go back to their home plane.
They just go back to the home plane.
And then they pop up at another plane and fight over there.
Right, and you know, maybe
G.I. Joe.
Maybe they're fighting, you know, maybe it's like a diversion on the devil's part to bring the demons to this world so that that force will be somewhere else when the devils want to go, mm-hmm. you know, elsewhere. It's sort of a cosmic, you know, game of chess.
Yeah.
Mordenkainen's has a good introduction to it.
Yeah.
There's a lot about the Blood War that I think a dungeon master, if they really want to use it, is going to want to think through. Mm-hmm. What do the conflicts look like? What do the actual battles look like? Who are the agents in this? What's at stake? What are the goals?
I think maybe just because we've been playing so much Warhammer recently, but now I'm thinking, because in Warhammer, I mean, the Witch Hunters, they're the good guys.
Heavy quotes,
good guys, right?
Yeah.
But like, imagine like you have demon cults that mm-hmm. are out and about, but with the orderly evil, they have this order of like witch hunters that goes out and keeps these cults in line. But but they are like proxy, they're proxy pawns.
There are
the
chaos
devils,
gods that hate other chaos gods that exist just to fight them. Yeah.
Like, and that'd be a fun way to play that out, that you could play that out.
It would be. Like the rivalry. I mean, and particularly like if you're talking demons, inter-demonic rivalry is intense. Mm-hmm. You know, even within the cult itself, maybe the you know, there's the figurehead of the cult leader, but there's also you know, rivals who want to usurp him for power or take over, or someone else that thinks, you know, that they can do it better. But then as you go up in scale, the whole conflict gets more. You know, tier one and tier two, it's about the city or the country they're in, the impact of this cult. Mm-hmm. By the time you get to tier three and tier four, it's about doing battle in the Blood War itself, or directly contributing to that. And then as you get higher and higher level, the stakes become higher and higher as the world gets drawn into this. And then there's an impact on the setting, right? Like there's the whole part of you're using these conflicts is that it's going to change your setting, playing out the ramifications of this conflict.
Exactly, and we'll get more in depth into that. Mm-hmm, but kind of sticking with the kind of types, like, you know, we've done like evil versus evil. And in most D&D settings, it is normally like good versus evil, right? You're a champion of good versus evil. But in a sense, I mean, that is a cosmic conflict. It's usually kept kind of in the background and nebulous, and it's just kind of like, oh, it's like our world, but, you know, there's actual spells being cast.
Right,
but,
right,
like,
right.
If you were to lean into the good versus evil, like where the gods are, like, sending their avatars down all the time, and, like, planetars, and, like, demons are, like, I mean, what would that look like? That'd be nuts,
yeah,
right?
You're touching on something like the Blood War is an example of it, but to take the archetype of the Blood War and, like, tease it out a bit, right? Like, a good versus evil cosmic scale conflict, it's going to get weird, I think, personally.
Yes.
Because mortals, not being, you know, as black and white as sort of celestials and fiends, are sort of caught in the middle. Is an angelic invasion just as bad as a demonic invasion? Is it just as disrupting to society, just as harmful to the flourishing of life that a demon invasion would be? I'm kind of thinking yes. Part of why I like the multiverse and the cosmos so much is because these are alien beings that are up here in the outer planes. And while they might hold to sort of tenets of, say, justice and fairness and generosity and charity and all the things that characterize good, they are absolutists.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's a moral absolutism that we don't, like, we ascribe to and we strive for, but we as humans
can't attain.
We can never get there, and it's all about, you know, it's the struggle, right?
Right.
But what happens when they come down and you now have someone's like, no, there are no pure thoughts in this town, otherwise you get to go to the pit.
Yeah.
Or, you know, and it's just like, but I've done so good, you know?
Yeah, I've done nothing. You know, maybe, you know, entire nations are conscripted by the forces of good to do battle against the forces of evil. And, and if they show up on your world, you know, start exerting influence, it very quickly becomes like why isn't the entire world engulfed in this conflict? Why aren't the angels going to every different court of every different human kingdom or dwarf kingdom or whatever, recruiting allies? Same with the forces of evil. Maybe if you want to feature a good versus evil type conflict, you bake that in. You say, like, perhaps the rulers of these worlds do have angelic and celestial advisors who seek to steer the humans, or mortals at least, along the direct course. Because they are, you know, so powerful, maybe they are aware of the fact that they can't come down in mass. That's kind of the answer that's usually given for a lot of these, is like the forces of good realize that if they were to directly intervene, it would be bad news for everybody. And so they sort of subtly influence.
Mm-hmm.
They provide aid and assistance and advice, and you should go here and do this thing.
Right, right.
In inkling or something, as opposed to like the blazing winged fiery sword hosts of heaven
coming down to be generals in your army,
right?
You know, no, you're going to send that million strong army over there and take that mountain.
But this is, of course, you know, the kind of campaign where I'm running, where it's, you know, it's the zealot barbarian, the paladin, the fighter with the acolyte background, and the war cleric.
Kind of shifting gears a little bit, can artifacts be of cosmic level influence enough in order to change the course of a campaign? Like, how would a DM think about, you know?
Yeah, I think what you're saying. Like,
you know what I mean?
There's a sense in which the powerful artifacts are on the same scale as sort of like gods and patrons and very powerful outsiders and fiends, celestials, and the like. Well, let's use for a minute sort of a set of artifacts that probably more people are going to be familiar with than D&D ones, and look at the Infinity Stones.
Yeah.
Right, like, I can't imagine running a game set in canon Marvel and not having the Infinity Stones be central, because the existence of something as powerful as the Infinity Stones means that someone out there is trying to get them.
And use them.
Mm-hmm. And they have a goal in mind. And one at some point, that will intersect with something that the party is doing.
Right.
Looking at sort of like D&D style artifacts, I'm thinking of something like the Rod of Seven Parts.
Mm-hmm.
Right. This is a powerful artifact used by the forces of law against the forces of chaos. The more pieces of it you assemble, the more powerful it gets. They also all have their own individual powers that they have. So you can like bear a piece of the rod, and even just a piece of it is pretty powerful. Assembling two pieces of it, is like it grows in power each time, right? If it exists in your world, then how is it not going to eventually, how is the conflict to recover that artifact, which has planar forces involved and is connected to this battle between chaos and law and all these other things, how does that not draw the party in?
Mm-hmm.
The answer is, for me, is it might. Right. It has the potential to, and you need to answer, if you're going to include things like this in your setting, why it isn't central in focus. And if it's not, then perhaps it's not a cosmic conflict. Perhaps it's just a large-scale one, but like the drow elf conflict. But it's not one that like takes over and has an impact on the meta setting of your own setting, right? Mm-hmm. The multiverse and all that kind of stuff.
Kind of like the ring.
Yeah, absolutely. The Ring of Sauron is one. The Wand of Orcus is another one, right?
Dude.
The Wand of Orcus is an artifact that if it finds its way to your campaign world, mm-hmm. every necromancer and death cultists and whatever is going to be after it. By extension, that means that there are going to be people opposing that. And if that conflict quickly gets out of control, then it has a potential to really impact your setting. If someone gets a hold of that wand and starts using it to create masses of undead and send them out in waves...
So it can create, what, like 500... Hit die?
Hit points.
Hit points, yeah. 500 hit points worth of undead.
Right, specifically for the wand, the dungeon master needs to work out exactly, they need to do some thinking on what that means. You know, are you using the average hit points mm-hmm. of the monsters? Are you not? Like, you know, I've seen for it, there are people who are like, it can summon an infinite number of undead a day because it will never reach above the average. Anyway,
I would say, okay, a bunch of skeletons, average 10 hit HP, so you can create 50 a day.
Right, yeah.
Right, but still. Like,
but there's more things you can summon with it. You can summon Draco Liches and Death Kiss Beholders, or not Death Kiss, but Death Tyrant Beholders, and all these kinds of things with it.
Well, some other things that can make undead also.
You can do a lot of things, right? So you summon a bunch of shadows, and then, you know.
But I mean, in your own experience, though, when you threw it in,
uh-huh.
I mean, it was part of Out of the Abyss.
It was part of Out of the Abyss. I threw in Wand of Orcus. Of course, I also had Black Razor, Axe of the Dwarvish Lords, and those were the three artifacts that ended up, and the Demonomicon was mm-hmm. another. And not so much with the Axe of the Dwarvish Lords. I didn't get to include that in any large-scale conflict. But both Black Razor, the Demonomicon, and the Wand of Orcus would eventually have drawn the party in to larger conflicts. And when we ended the campaign, Black Razor was already starting to be... Like, your character bears it, starting to realize that there are factions out there. Both, like, capital F Planescape factions. Mm-hmm. The Doomguard really wanted Black Razor.
Yeah, that's why I got rid of it.
But also others that realize, okay, this weapon is now in play. And if we were to play through that campaign at epic levels, then it would be a case of these are one of many weapons that are being assembled by someone or some entity or something that wants to use them for a cosmic scale mm-hmm. goal or something that they have.
Yeah, that's why I got rid of it.
But there's a lot of others, right? Like, when you start thinking about cosmic scale conflicts, I mean, you can do like the god, like Pantheon versus Pantheon is one, gods of law versus gods of chaos. But then there's also like, consider the influence of the demon lords on Greyhawk.
Yeah.
Right, like Greyhawk's one of those settings where the demon lords, they're off spawning, you know, Cambion demon princes that rule over portions of the setting. They are exerting their influence, setting up cults, setting up fake cults to sort of misdirect people. They have schemes and desires and goals that they want to accomplish in the Prime Material. And so when I look at the lore of Greyhawk and I see the work of Grazitz or Zogtmi or Eus or any of the other demon lords that are there, this is a setting in which the outer planes of it are fully integrated into the Prime Material. To me, there's some of the other default D&D settings like Forgotten Realms and some others, like those things seem very remote and distant. And I know a lot of people complain about how active the gods are in Forgotten Realms, but to me, they're not active enough. I see that in Greyhawk, where it's like, these are cosmic level conflicts. The entities involved here have cosmic level interests. They have they have the resources and the power to wage a cosmic scale across multiple planes. And if this thing plays out in your world, it's going to change your campaign setting. That's the whole point of the cosmic conflict, is it will change your campaign world. Think of the Archfey, right?
Yeah.
Think of all the different patrons of the Archfey.
Mm-hmm.
Is there not
been
a
doing
case?
That a lot lately.
They're not a case of like. Do they not scheme against each other? Are their warlocks not in competition with each other?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right.
Because you want the best and the brightest, right?
Right.
You need to pull these mortals to your version
of
perfection.
You need a vessel that's suitable for channeling your power. Mm-hmm. And so maybe there's competition for warlocks amongst the various patrons. Maybe that conflict, that game of which one of these mortals is going to end up with me.
Yeah.
Fuels an entire, you know, conflict that goes on behind the scenes of a campaign setting.
Yeah, now I'm just thinking of like there's like a fey draft. Like where they have like a draft and they're like all the warlocks are on up for for draft this year. They're ready. Oh, he's got a great 40 time, but he's slow on the
slow, a little slow with that Eldritch Blast.
But yeah, he's he's projected mid second round, but I think he'll end up with Tatiana really. He's lean summer.
There you go. He likes, lean summer.
Plays better in warm weather.
These are the players involved, and eventually higher level D&D characters are players in these. Like tier 4 D&D characters, particularly you start getting above 17th level and into like epic level campaigns, you are dealing with cosmic scale conflicts. And I'll be perfectly honest, if you don't have players who at that scale aren't thinking cosmically, then you're going to have a difficult time with these tiers of play because we're not talking fucking rats in a sewer anymore.
No, I mean, once plane shift starts happening and you can start opening gates,
once you can alter the fabric of reality on a daily basis,
then you should expect that as a player.
You should expect that as a player. You should be using those resources as a tool for your player. And if high-level play is interesting to you, if it's something that you want to explore and want to make work for you, then baking in a cosmic scale conflict, even if it's something that doesn't get introduced until tier 3 or tier 4, you just kind of keep it in the background. You just know, okay, I built my pantheon like this. I set up a cosmic conflict that's like that. It's between these gods and these gods, and these demon lords are involved, and these planar entities are involved, and these are the consequences, and here's what's going to happen. And then you just kind of have it poised and ready. You can foreshadow it throughout the campaign. You can drop hints, little bits of lore, reference the kind of thing. And then when you bring it out of the back burner and you put it front and center, the players know, like, oh yeah, this is a conflict that's been foreshadowed. We've talked about it before. Now we're in the shit.
Earlier we were discussing like what your world looks like in the afterglow of these these conflicts. So we have a couple of campaign worlds.
We do have a couple of campaign worlds,
and they both are heavily influenced by this subject. When thinking through the ramifications of what your world looks like in the afterglow of the cosmic conflict, walk us through like Land Between Two Rivers and how that's shaped by that.
Yeah, so Land Between Two Rivers is a post-apocalyptic setting in which the campaign world has undergone a magical cataclysm. This is an idea that I borrowed from Greyhawk. There's the invoked devastation and the reign of colorless fire in the background of the Greyhawk setting that I read about and was just like, oh yeah, this is fucking cool. And so in the Land Between Two Rivers setting, there was a campaign, we may have talked about it before in some of our videos, where my first third edition campaign, it was drow with vampire magic gonna block out the sun. They were drawing power from both Illithids, who had a vested interest in seeing the sun blotted out, as well as some demon forces who were interested in sort of turning this world into a stronghold of evil so that they could use it as a base of operations in the Blood War. The drow succeed in blotting out the sun, thanks in large part to an untimely TPK that was actually the result of player actions here.
Players ignore the cosmic conflict.
They ignored the cosmic conflict and for their own, and that's what happened, right? Half the players convinced the other half that doing their own thing and fighting one of their potential allies was a better course of action, and I just let the ramifications of that play out. And it was one of those moments where it was like, I could try to steer the campaign world to where I would like it to go, but that feels selfish, and it feels like that we get a lot of pushback, and so I would just like, let's let this play out. And what it meant is that I destroyed this campaign world. It was wrecked.
Yeah, your players made you burn your own world down.
I did, yeah, I did. And well, in this case, I froze it to death, because as the sun was blotted out, of course, there's a new Ice Age, blah, 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 whatever. We then played a second campaign in which the players played people who were trying to break the hold of the drow on the world, and that conflict, combined with the environmental devastation of not having a sun for 100 years, created this desert world of nothing, where humans and elves and dwarves have all been driven to extinction or left. All the gods abandoned the world. In that period between when the sun comes back and the Land Between Two Rivers starts is this period of like a global wizard's war. And the demons opening up a front on the Blood War on this planet, and the demons and devils fighting each other over this planet, and the wizards and powerful celestials that were called in to help break the back of the drow are bringing in all of these planar allies that they've been gathering for more than 100 years, and all of this technology and magical power to fight the drow. And of course, the drow aren't going down. They're going to fight for every square inch that they have, and that just, it breaks the world. And I had all these ramifications for it. I was like, you know, the world is thrown out of its time stream. It does not experience its own time linearly anymore. Mm-hmm. And it's easy to summon things there. Planar travel is incredibly easy. It hasn't come up yet, but every time someone teleports, it has the potential to open a brand new permanent portal that will just be there to somewhere, right? A misty step has the potential to open a portal to limbo. That's how fragile this world's place in reality is.
Yeah, the veil between planes has become very permeable.
It's paper thin and permeable. And so I did that because I wanted a world in which I could, if I wanted to throw in a mech suit, I could. If I wanted to give the party an M60, I could. I wanted something where I could get really weird and gonzo, but it's based on this cosmic conflict that started with the drow seeking advantage, gaining allies, which those allies draw them into a larger one, and then when that blows up, this prime material world is toast. Mm-hmm. Casualties were rampant. People are driven to extinction. Society collapsed. And Land Between Two Rivers is just playing in the aftermath of that. No one knows shit. This is all ancient history to anybody that's currently alive in the setting.
Right. It is a fun world to play in, and knowing that my characters had a hand in making it.
Yeah.
Both for ill and good.
But Starward Bound has a similar kind of feel to it, where there was a large-scale conflict.
Yeah, I mean, like mine was much more I wouldn't say mundane, but I based it off of our history, World War I and World War II.
Yeah.
Except there are these interspherical wars where the beholders are basically the evil Germans that are invading, and then the humans, dwarves, and elves all gather together and have to fight them off, and with their begrudging allies, the Illithids, because the Illithids are like, well, you know, we don't want them to take over, really, so I guess we'll help you out, kind of. You know, and everybody's like, okay, but it's where you're fighting your enemies while you're looking over your shoulder at that one ally.
Yeah.
Looking at you, Russia, back then. And it's a thing where, you know, the beholders drove basically humanity to the point of extinction, to where there's only like four worlds left with refugees, and now you are coming out of the shadows and the smog of war, and it's finally cleared a couple of hundred years later, and it's like, okay, now we can kind of step back into our former territory, which has now been like broken and lawless for a century or two. And then, of course, in the background, there's a lot going on that is more veiled.
But it's like a conflict that influences almost everything in the world. Like, every place you go has a place in this conflict. We're talking like hundreds of worlds involved in this, right?
Yeah, hundreds of spheres where you're reducing humanity from probably 100 spheres down to like 8. Like, when you look at the map, the vortex map, you know, the one arm is really like it. That's all that's left. Yeah. And there were a bunch of spheres like north of that and further in. And they're just, well, they might still be there, but they are no longer under human control. But that's the fun. And like, you go back in and there's beholder cults everywhere, where there's like beholders left behind after the war. Mm-hmm. And cults have sprung up around them. And, you know, there's all these eye cults, or just broken spheres. Like the spheres themselves have been shattered. You have rogue planets flying around in the Phlogiston, or just a rogue solar system in the Phlogiston, unprotected. So what evolves out of that? Like, I have a few ideas for that. But what happens in the wake of this, where it just kind of shatters civilization as you know it, and now you have to go back in and kind of retame it.
Dealing with the ramifications of the presence of a cosmic conflict in your campaign world means that you're going to change it. For people out there who are looking for another kind of example that's a bit more low-key, I would suggest the Lamentations of the Flame Princess product, Kelong. That's Q-E-L-O-N-G, and it's sort of a fantasy Cambodia in which next door there's a wizard war going on, and a artifact of that war makes it into this setting. It's a very tightly focused, small hex crawl that you kind of walk around, but you can see how, like, just playing through the ramifications of the fact that there's a cosmic conflict on this setting's doorstep. You never get to the conflict in the module. It's literally like two lines of writing before they move on to other stuff, but you can tell that in the setting, the fact that there have been these two wizards engaged in this battle with each other has devastated this wasteland, creating mutations and magical radiation and leakage, and like a powerful demon goddess is unbound because of it, and people are going insane and sort of like turning to banditry and cannibalism and all this other stuff. And it's a great example of using this kind of cosmic scale conflict as a source of adventure, even if the point of the adventure isn't to resolve the conflict. It's just to have it present, and now the party's dealing with the ramifications of it.
And the unicorn invasion of Dundee. Because if you didn't know, Travis, fireballs and lightning are raining from the sky.
Yeah, I mean, I heard about that part. I think everybody knows about the fireballs and the lightning.
I mean, chaos does surround us while the people die.